Dear colleagues, dear fellow phenomenologists, I am very happy to welcome you all to the fifth International Symposium on Phenomenological Research in Education. The relation of emotions, pedagogy, and phenomenology will be in the focus in the next 3 days. Now I will start with a little presentation, a little insight on our topic, and this is Bildung, feeling, emotions, learning, pedagogical perspectives. And I have prepared a little presentation in which I try to highlight some aspects of the connection between emotions and Bildung. I will try to present two theses. The first thesis is emotions serve the function of the life world orientation as well as a function for social and moral judgment, and thirdly, a function of Bildung. The second thesis is emotions can be seen as a starting point for a reflexive process of Bildung. The relation of the self and world is put into resonance in a special way so that a transformation of the person, a reversal, becomes possible. Before I start, I will give some remarks on terms and their translations, because for us it's sometimes quite hard to translate all the terms from Husserl and from our pedagogical tradition in English. So I will try to explain first Bildung. What is Bildung? Bildung means an interplay between human and the world, in which an experience takes place that changes the person as a whole, like Humboldt said. This change can be described as a transformation or a reversal. In Greek, Platon says it's a periagoge, a reversal, eine Umwendung. It's a subjective and eventful lived experience in learning or in Bildung, which is based on negativity, as I will show afterwards. This lived experience in Bildung, bildende Erfahrung, lived experience in Bildung, is connected to Wissen und Können, which I translate with Ryle and Polanyi as knowing that and knowing how. Knowing that, wissen, wissen, knowing how, können. I systematically distinguish Bildung from education. Education is a social practice which takes place in institutions like family or school. I translate the German word Gefühl as emotion. But in German we have the word emotion as well. I translate Gefühl with emotion, and I will define it later, more precisely. Shame, and I will refer to the example of shame, is an emotion. I translate Schamgefühl as an actual and momentary lived experience of shame, as a feeling of shame. So I differentiate Erfahrung from Erlebnis. Erfahrung, experience, Erlebnis, lived experience. So the German word Erlebnis is an eventful and immediate emotion. And we will find it, Husserl talks about Erlebnis, Heidegger, Bollnow, and so on. So I translate Erlebnis as lived experience. Experience, in contrast to Erlebnis, is repeated and sedimented experience. And last but not least, I translate the German word Stimmung, like Heidegger, Angst, as mood. This is a special way of emotion and lived experience of emotions. Later I will distinguish moods from atmospheres. But first I will give an example and briefly discuss the history of feelings in philosophy, the humanities, and pedagogy. In the processes and practices of learning, education, teaching, Bildung, socializations, emotions are omnipresent across all professions and disciplines, curiosity, surprise, anger, fear, envy, shame, and so on. Even love, compassion, thankfulness are central moments of experience, of learning and building. Emotions give a structure of our engagement and relation with the self, with the others, and with the world. Since the late 1990s, the forgotten connections between emotions and education are being rediscovered in the course of the so-called emotional term in philosophy, history, anthropology, sociology, pedagogy as well. For a long time, in pedagogy, emotions were overlooked, and the important and productive relevance of emotions, their specific meaning for the individual, are not seen. They were still and still are regarded as adversaries or disturbances to reason and rationality. Phenomenology has reversed this European logocentrism by describing and researching emotions. Based on Husserl's concepts on intentionality, Scheler and Heidegger claim the priority of emotions over thought and will. From a phenomenological perspective, emotions bear an outstanding priority and significance for relations between the self, the world, and the others. To illustrate my thoughts on emotions, I would like to give a brief example. This example originates from our research. It's a research in phenomenological videography, and we are studying the phenomenon of attention in teaching and learning. And this is a ninth grade chemistry class, the girl in the black back row here. She is called upon by the teacher to present to the class the results of an experiment. In this moment, only a few seconds, one clearly can see a bodily reaction or an answer to the teacher's request, widened eyes. Her gaze is surprised and fixed. Then she smiles. Her cheeks redden. Her gaze sinks down. The girl gets up and pulls her sweater down. Her body tension increases and her body tone becomes rigid. The teacher encourages her to come forward to the blackboard. There she presents the results of her experiments in front of the other, mostly male students, who were, in the moment she is coming to the blackboard, smirching to her. You are probably familiar with these situations. Situations like these at school, you probably say, the girl is ashamed. She is ashamed to have to give an answer in front of the others, to have to stand up, to have to present herself by the blackboard in front of everyone and maybe demonstrate her lack of knowing that and knowing how. Shame and, as I will show, perhaps all emotions are characterized by, by a three-figure structure. Firstly, they express themselves in an embodied way. They are perceptible. This process cannot be controlled, neither by will nor by rationality. The feeling of shame, Schamgefühl, is overwhelming. It resembles an unexpected empathic event. One avoids the gaze of the others, wants to sink, wants to hide. In the feeling of shame, a self-relation appears. Secondly, in the feeling of shame, a sociality becomes manifest. The self-relation is experienced in front of the others and through others. It is a feeling of oneself that remains related to the others. This creates an unpleasant, tense, and finally crisis-like lived experience. The self-control, the social mask, and role of the students slip away, and something very personal appears. The girl is ashamed of herself in front of others about something. This is the third aspect. The girl's turned red, blushes, because she anticipates the judgment of the other students at the very moment. She is confronted with the gazes of the others. Therefore, the feeling of shame has an object, a correlate to success. It is directed at something specific that is experienced in the very moment, or that is at least being anticipated. So we can say this is a point Husserl calls the intentionality of emotions, or of our perception. It is directed to an object. In phenomenology, we have a more precise conceptual distinctions on emotions. First, I want to distinguish the broader concept of emotions that contains all forms of affects from a narrower concept. Emotions in a narrower concept are firstly intentionally directed at something. I am happy about a bouquet of flowers. I envy someone's success. I am ashamed of something. So emotions are intentional and have a propositional content, an object. The lived experience character of emotions is an unmistakably personal experience. Emotions can only be experienced in the first person perspective. Scheler shows that I can empathize with the emotions of another, but if someone has toothache, I don't have the toothache by myself. I only can sympathize with it. The toothache can only be experienced in the first person perspective. So we can see this is, it can be shared, the emotions, but the primacy emotion is the first person perspective. And this implies, because of the passive perspective, a rejection of the traditional European notion of the sovereignty and autonomy of the subject. The emotional experience is rather based on passivity, a lived experience and a state of mind that marks the fundamental heteronomy of the subject. In this way, phenomenology can decenter the notion of the autonomous subject without having to abandon the subjectivity in the first-person perspective. In this context, another characteristic of emotions becomes clear. The experience of emotions is to be distinguished from sensory perceptions. All emotions are embodied, but they transcend sensual perception by being directed towards something or someone, and thereby receive their quality and their intensity. Emotions are sensory, lived experience as a correlate of an act. In joy, shame, or envy, I experience myself in front of the others by feeling joy about something, by being ashamed of something, or being envying someone. The next point, moods. In German, we say Stimmung, and atmospheres can be distinguished from emotions. Moods such as fear, worry, melancholy, euphoria, serenity, thoughtfulness, and so on, boredom, sadness, are in phenomenology regarded as basic states of being in the world, Heidegger said. In contrast to emotions and feelings, moods can be seen as an affect. It has no correlate, no object. Mood is diffuse, of longer duration, not bound to a certain situation or place. Moods generate an affective foundation against a background of which emotions can't stand out. The German word Stimmung comes from music. Strings of a violin or piano are tuned, gestimmt, in mood. They are then linked together in resonance with each other. A mood, therefore, needs a resonance and thus an answer to others and to the other, the world. Mood, Stimmung, feels, grasps, and evaluates without speech and without rational judgment. Moods, as well as emotions, create a fundamental responsivity to the world, to oneself, and to the others as a pre-rational and pre-conceptual level. They open up to the world, and at the same time, they close off. Third point, atmosphere. Atmospheres can be distinguished from emotions and moods. Atmospheres are also affects, but in a spatial and material context. Like moods, atmospheres are diffuse. In atmospheres, space is not perceived as an objective, measurable space, but in a non-objective way, in the mode of being effectively touched. The non-objective impression of space, the things and the people in it, constitute the atmosphere, like in this room here. Atmospheres, therefore, also can be characterized by a state of being tuned, like moods, as I explained before. They respond to colors, smells, things, constellations, peoples, and architectures in space. Okay, so now I want to say one brief note on negativity. Negativity in phenomenological research, and then I start my perspective on shame. In phenomenological research and education, they developed a genuinely phenomenological theory of Bildung, learning, and relearning. Here, learning is regarded as an experience in which someone makes an experience through something specific and through someone specific. Negative experience play a prominent role in this theory of learning. They are not to be understood in the everyday sense like bad experiences. And they are not opposed to the good or positive experience. Rather, they describe a specific understanding of negativity that lies beyond this dualistic notion of good and bad, and that emphasizes the productive potentials of negativity. Husserl's analysis of intentionality shows that the horizon structure of experience is connected to the relation between fulfillment and disappointment of anticipation. Günther Buch, he points this out in his theory of learning in this book, Lernen und Erfahrung. The intention within experience is directed towards something or someone in the future, in the mode of anticipation. Learning thus takes place in the tension between knowing that, knowing how, and not knowing that, and not knowing how. This is the negative notion of the anticipation in learning. Socrates, Plato, Aristotle, they knew this. If what was anticipated is not realized, the learner faces an irritation. By experiencing a difference between the present experience and the previous experiences. These negative experiences or negative instances in experience, in learning experience, are encountered as moments of not knowing that, not knowing how, as failures, as interruptions, moments of forgetting, and Heidegger says, unreadiness to hand, Unzuhandenheit. An interspace or space in between emerges. This space should be seen, not seen from the endpoint, but from the presence of the experience and the learner himself. In this interspace opens up a space between knowing that and not knowing that, between knowing how and not knowing how. in this space perhaps some kind of foreignness as a negative experience, a passive experience occurs. It steps out of the order, befalls oneself, irritates what is familiar to us, what we know or what we know how to do. Negative experience as well as irritating and disappointing experiences point back to the self and the world relation of the learner. The structure of experience in this can give a new index, like Husserl said. It is transformed, it is changed. The experience of Bildung is therefore a transformational experience based on negative moments of disappointment and irritation. And it's elementarily connected with a sense of foreignness and with the temporarily indicated space in between. How this is a connection to time, I will show later. So, we can say in this learning, phenomenological learning theory, we focus something else than the cognitivist theories of competence and cognitive learning. Now, in the next step, I would like to describe this reflections on emotion and Bildung and learning using the example of shame. I want to point out again the example of the chemistry lesson. As soon as the girl in the example is called to the blackboard, physical reactions become apparent. Widened eyes, tense smile, redness of the cheeks, lowered gaze, they are known to all of us as possible expressions of shame. We said, in the feeling of shame, one's own relation to oneself is experienced. The self-relation is experienced in a passive way. One wants to sink in the ground. This embodied self-feeling experiences the vulnerability of one's own self. At the same time, it arises in front of the others who are present or in front of imaginary others, in the face and in response to the gaze of the others. Now, like Sartre points out in his Phenomenology of Shame, shame is both a subjective, personal, and a social feeling. In the lived experience of shame, one's own self-relation is experienced as a crisis. The student is expected to present herself, to show herself, to present her knowledge and her skills to the public. She is expected to show herself in front of the gaze and remarks of the other students. But one's own in Deutschen heißt es das eigene, also the own of the person, does not want to enter the public sphere. One's own does not want to be displayed or judged or even to be exposed. It must be masked, the mask. Here, the anthropological meaning of the mask is revealed. The mask, in Latin, persona. The persona, or one can say it well, prevents the private form becoming public, the hidden from becoming visible. The mask guarantees the person's own. Without mask, there's no personality. From Plato to Lips to Plessner, the feeling of shame is therefore seen as the beginning of self-consciousness. Shame has an elementary function in the formation of identity that always remains volatile, precarious, and unstable. The reversal of the Eurocentric prejudices I mentioned before manifests itself in this point. It is not reason and autonomy forming the beginning of self-relation and identity, but the feeling of shame, perhaps, as the guardian of the ego and one's identity. The reserve of those who are shy and shameful illustrates not only the embodiment, but also the gender aspect in our example. The crisis-like nature of the embodied and gender-based self-relation is experienced as particularly strong in times of physical maturation and development in adolescence. The reaction of the boys, their suggestive smirks and their shouts reinforce this once again. The student tidies her sweater. She feels, as we say in German, uncomfortable in her skin. Embodiment, its gender aspect and its visibility are central moments of shame. I would like to extend this phenomenological analysis further with regard to the temporality of the feeling of shame. The presence of the feeling of shame in its embodied genderly character is apparent in the gaze of the others. We have seen this now. The presence of shame is thus related to a possible future as a feeling of a border, of not wanting to reveal one's own in public and one's own hidden from the gazes. The feeling of shame is preventive, sometimes prohibitive. Shame can therefore occur in the preliminary stages of a possible embarrassment in order to present it. In this respect, shame is also a sense of anticipation. This is where the above-mentioned orientation function of feelings becomes obvious. We said earlier that the norms and values of culture, society, and institutions articulate themselves in the gaze of the others. If I am ashamed of others, then I'm ashamed of myself through experiences they're experiencing their values as my own. The student experiences a norm without being its author. The social and institutional norms of the school are performance standards that the teacher, but also the other students, restitute. They are also norms of knowing that and knowing how, that are ought to be presented here in public. By experiencing these norms and values in shame as one's own, they are evaluated. They are experienced as something offensive, or as something valuable, or as something unworthy. The potential evaluation by the others and the anticipation of the potential failure creates an embarrassment of not being able to fulfill these demands. The situation can therefore be grasped in regard to senses of feelings which are experienced as possible threats to one's self-esteem. The feeling of shame thus also has an evaluative moral function with regard to one's own evaluations in the same situation in the face of cultural and social norms and values. The student seems to be ashamed of something in front of others. So self-relation, not knowing how, not knowing that, in front of the others, as the norms and values reference. Let's try to describe the negativity of the feeling in the feeling of shame. How exactly does the judgment take place in shame? Or to put it in another way, what is the relation between one's own and the foreign, between one's own self-esteem and the evaluation of the others who embody foreign norms and values? I would like to argue there's an existential negativity, a crisis, a conflict in self-esteem, a foreignness that is existentially experienced in the gaze of others and then transformed into foreignness and otherness of one's own self. Foreign perspectives and self-perspectives become intertwined. The imposition of shame consists precisely in exposing oneself to foreign values against the background of one's own values. The non-dialectic negativity of the feeling of shame plays between one's own and the foreign, between non-recognition of the others and non-recognition of one's own, between the visible and the hidden in an interspace. The feeling of shame is therefore more the awareness of a border, a difference in an intermediate area. This is the axiological function of the feeling of shame. It is based on an elementary, embodied, and existential structure of reflection, the relation to oneself in the face and in the response to others. This, I would like call proto-reflexive relationship, is experienced in shame. The cognitivist appraisal theories treat feelings as a counterpart of reason that is submitted to a cognitive evaluation and reflection process. This can't grasp this specific inner logic of shame in its personal, social, and pedagogical dimensions. Against the background of the phenomenological analysis, it should have become clear that feelings and emotions, in contrast to the cognitivist views, have their own rationality, which manifests itself in their orientational and evaluational function. Now, in the last step, I would like to point out the Bildungsfunktion of shame, which is closely related to the points I said before. We have explored now two functions of feeling, the social function of shame, to be able to prohibitively avoid injuries, as well as a moral and existential function of shame, to experience a difference between bodily, genderly, and one's own norms and values. Now, they are to be expanded by a perspective on Bildung. I would like to point out a connection between the overwhelming feeling of shame as a pathic feeling on the one hand and the negative experiences of learning described before on the other hand. The student's feeling of shame in our example is socially structured by situation, the institution, and the gaze of the others. The social field proves to be one of social distinctions under special conditions of the school in which the students provided academic performances is evaluated and certified. If we now look at the first person perspective, it becomes clear that these norms are experienced existentially as one's own. They immediately provoke embodied reactions like blushing. In the feeling of shame, not only judgments are experienced in the horizon of social or institutional norms, but also evaluations are carried out. In the case of the students from our example, these evaluations relate to her relation to knowledge and ability. Against the background of the theory of negativity, it now becomes clear that the prohibitive function of shame can also be defined with regard to the experiences of not knowing that, not knowing how. The student is embarrassed because she does not know whether what she knows is wrong or right. In the feeling of shame, the possibility of not knowing that and not knowing how is experienced and anticipated as one's own. In our example, the feeling of shame is not caused by an insult or diminution in value by the teacher. It rather arises immediately with the call. The call is a conventional form in the classroom, and in our tradition, we say it's some kind of counteraction education. Schleiermacher called it entgegenwirkende Erziehung, which, while preserving the personality of person to be educated, opens up the possibility of revealing mistakes, ignorance, and incompetence. This happens because the process of learning can begin with a negative experience. In this sense, the possibility of Bildung opens up in the context of shame. The feeling of shame can thus be described as the effect of an educational act. This educational act can be described not as a submission or as a non-recognition. I want to argue that it can be seen as a practice of care, which deals tactfully and adequately with the individual personality. It does not evade the responsibility to initiate the learning process. Education as care knows that learning begins with negativity and that shame, therefore, has a constitute and productive significance for the process of learning and Bildung. Rather, care intends to open up a negative experience as a beginning of motion of Bildung. The one who is ashamed knows that he or she might be missing, certain knowing that or knowing how. Yet, he or she also does not know what the right knowledge is, although he or she anticipates it. Here, too, the earlier mentioned intermediate and existential space between one's own and the foreign opens up. This can be described in a pedagogical situation as a space between knowing that and knowing how, on the one hand, and not knowing that and not knowing how, on the other hand. It can, therefore, be said the Bildungsfunction of shame is mediated through a negativity that is still open and undefined. In this interspace of shame, between knowing and not knowing, the possibility of a lived experience of Bildung opens up. The educational function of shame, therefore, corresponds with the orientational function in the social field and the moral evaluation function in the embodied genderly field. In this way, it becomes clear. The feeling of shame, in the feeling of shame, Bildung arises through emotions, and at the same time, the specific meaning of the feeling of shame enables a Bildung of emotion insofar as learning experience can begin with negative experiences. Thus, shame can have a constitutive and productive meaning for learning and Bildung. Thank you very much.